Simon & Schuster Audio presents Firstborn by Tor Seidler. Read by Jenni Barber. With an introduction by the author.
Hello, I'm Tor Seidler. The seed for this book was planted about 20 years ago when a friend of mine brought the writer Gene Craighead George to a publication party for one of my books. I was thrilled to meet her, being a big fan of her books, My Side of the Mountain, and especially Julia the Wolves. She was a lot older than me, a lot older than my mother for that matter, but the glint in her eye was that of a curious kid, and to my delight we hit it off. At the time, Gene was very excited about the reintroduction of wolves into Yellowstone Park. This was news to me. She explained to me how ranchers and hunters had wiped out the wolf population from the lower 48 states back in the 1920s, and how the ecology of places like Yellowstone had suffered from the loss of the top predator. The years passed and our friendship solidified, and in 2005, Gene invited me to go out to Yellowstone to see the wolves for myself. Of course, I said yes. We flew out in late May and spent some time on a Craighead family ranch down in the Tetons, then switched our base to a motel in Montana just outside the northeast corner of the park. Some days were spring-like, some days it snowed, but every dawn we'd be at a lookout spot from which we could watch the Slough Creek pack from across a ravine in the Lamar Valley. With 5 newborn pups, the pack had just grown to 26 wolves. When we got there, the babysitter wolves would usually be playing with the pups on a grassy slope. Then the alpha male would lead the other hunters back to the den site. Often he'd howl to announce his arrival, and then they would distribute meat to the excited pups. Gene knew all about the wolves' prey and their hierarchy and behavior. Even the park rangers quizzed her about them. And she knew about the rest of the incredible variety of wildlife out there, too. The coyotes, pronghorns, elk, buffalo, moose, grizzly bears, not to mention the bird life. Needless to say, I learned an awful lot. After we got home from this amazing experience, Jean would say, "When are you going to write one of your books about the wolves?" By that, she meant one of my whimsical, anthropomorphic stories. When it came to writing about animals, Jean was a real naturalist, whereas I suppose I'm more of a fabulist. I'd written about some uncuddly creatures, like rats and weasels and woodchucks, but I figured wolves were too violent for my kind of treatment. So I kept procrastinating, even after Jean sent me a series of long emails full of information she'd picked up about wolves over the decades. Then in May 2012, Jean died at the age of 92. The next month, I finally sat down to write the book. In her honor, I wanted a female narrator. Since magpies are scavengers who often feed on wolf kills, I came up with Maggie the Magpie, a storyteller who could give us a true bird's-eye view of the goings-on. Of course, once I started, the novel took on a life of its own. I wrote it in New York City, but most of the time I felt as if I was back out there in Wyoming. As for the title, I couldn't resist it. I'd written about 100 pages when my first child was born. I look forward to the day when my firstborn can read Firstborn. In the meantime, I hope you enjoy it.
1. "Come see, Max," my mother cried. "Max, come see." My father landed on the rim of the nest and held something over me in his black beak. I'd just broken through my shell. There were several other grayish-green shells around me, all still intact. I craned my neck, grabbed the morsel out of my father's beak, and gulped it down. "Isn't she the most adorable little magpie in the whole world?" my mother crooned. "Cute, cute, cute. What shall we call her?"
"Up to you, Mag," said my father. "You did most of the work."
"How about Maggie?"
"Perfect."
I gawped at them in disbelief. Here I was, a minute-old magpie with a mother named Mag and a father named Max,
and they were calling me Maggie. My only consolation was that they weren't much more imaginative with my five siblings. As my brothers and sisters hatched around me, they were dubbed Mark, Marge, Mandy, Mac, and Matt. On a brighter note, I wasn't just first out of the egg, I was also the first of the brood to make it to the edge of the nest. "What's this place called?" I asked, looking out.
"Home," my mother said. "Isn't it glorious, glorious, glorious?"
It was quite a view, though of course I had little to compare it to. "What are those green things?" I said, peering straight down.
"Branches. We're in a pine tree."
She pointed out other pine trees, a farmhouse, a smaller structure called a hen house, a bigger one called a barn, and two tall things with egg-shaped tops called silos. Between the silos was a glittering ribbon of blue. In the distance, there were fenced-in fields, some trees with leaves instead of needles, and vast expanses of open range.
"What are the four-legged beasts?" I asked.
"Cattle." "Where's their nest?"
"There," she said, pointing her beak at the barn.
The small box-like thing on top of the barn was called a cupola, and the thing on top of that was a weather vane. The weather vane had a bird perched on it. "Is that a magpie?" I asked.
"That homely old thing?
He's a crow." Hopping onto the sunny side of the nest, my mother spread her wings and flicked her tail.
"You're the most beautiful ma in the world," cooed my brother Matt.
How many mothers did he know, I wondered. Though, in fact, ours was pretty striking. Her black and white plumage had a hint of iridescent green, and her tail was long and graceful. She and my father devoted the next few days to bringing us lovely insects and succulent bits of carrion. As our fluff turned to feathers, our parents warned us of creatures to avoid once we left the nest.
"Keep a sharp eye out for eagles and foxes."
"Watch out for hawks and coyotes."
"Foxes and house cats."
"Coyotes and rattlesnakes and eagles."
"Did we mention foxes?"
As we grew, the nest got more and more cramped, and despite the looming perils, I yearned to be free of it. But the only way out of the nest was by air, and my first attempt at flying was a disaster. If not for a well-placed bough, I'd have broken my neck. I did better on my second try, however, and by the time I was a month old, I was giving my siblings flying lessons. Life without wings must be a bitter thing. You'd miss out on not only the freedom, but the perspective. Flying lets you see from close up or far away. You can zoom up to things, and if you don't like the look of them, zoom away. At first, I steered well clear of cattle. They're enormous and smelly. But one day, I saw my father alight on one. I fluttered down and landed gingerly beside him.
"They're so dull, they don't mind," he said. "Dig in, Maggie."
The beast was covered with ticks. It was a feast. Horses and dogs pick up ticks as well, but horses are less docile than cattle, with dangerous tails. And dogs are absolute monsters to be avoided at all cost. Though humans pick up fewer ticks, I developed a soft spot for them anyway. The silly creatures were always discarding tasty garbage. By summer, my whole clutch had left the nest for good. Sadly, the creek that wound between the silos dried up, so we had to drink from the cattle trough.
Blech!
And except for a few trees, the whole landscape turned dull brown with dust devils swirling across it. Then came winter, and everything turned stark white. The days were short and cold, the nights long and even colder. The cattle huddled in the barn. One day, I noticed steam leaking out of the cupola. The homely old crow was still on the weather vane, and he was more than twice my size. But crows hadn't been on my parents' list of creatures to avoid, and I couldn't see why he should hog all the heat. Besides, I'd become as handsome as my mother. And I figured he might be flattered by a visit from someone so much better looking. I flew over and landed on the cupola. The steam felt wonderful, even if it stank. But the crow glared down from the weather vane. "Scram," he said. "Why?" I said. "There's plenty of room." "I can't abide magpies."
"What's wrong with magpies?"
"They're empty-headed chatterboxes."
"Who says?"
"Ask anybody." I flew off and found a starling perched on the ice-glazed swing set behind the farmhouse.
"What sort of reputation do magpies have?" I asked.
"Thieving hoarders," the starling said.
This wasn't very flattering, but at least it didn't confirm the crow.
I flew over to a thrush poking around by the garbage cans behind the house and asked her the same question.
"Empty-headed chatterboxes," she said.
I gulped.
A buzzard on a telephone pole gave me the same answer. I returned to my favorite ponderosa pine to nurse my bruised ego. At sunset, I tucked my head under my wing as usual, but I couldn't sleep. Thinking back, I realized my parents and siblings did chatter a lot. I remembered my mother calling home, "Glorious, glorious, glorious." Now that I'd experienced a sweltering, dull brown summer and a snowy sub-zero winter, I had to question that. But even if some magpies didn't think before they spoke, did that mean I was like that? In the morning, I flew to the cupola, determined to prove the crow wrong, but he wasn't on the weather vane. While I was basking in the smelly warmth, I spotted him down below, walking out from between two bulging roots of an old cottonwood tree. I figured he must have had a food cache there. Out on the sun-struck snow, he opened his impressive wings and pushed off. The lower part of the weather vane was four arrows pointing in different directions. The top part was shaped like a horse. The horse moved in the wind and squeaked when the crow landed on it.
"Scat,"
the crow said. I ignored him. He roughed up his feathers, doubling his size. I crouched, ready to take off. Down below, a door banged. A human came out of the farmhouse, followed by a dog. They got into one of their vehicles. It rumbled to life, spewing a bluish cloud into the clear air, and rolled away, the tires kicking up the dry snow just as they kicked up the dust in the summer. At the end of a long straightaway, the vehicle passed through a gate and turned left. By the time the vehicle was out of sight, the crow had deflated to his normal size. I stayed put for about an hour, till I was nice and toasty, before flying away. When I returned to the cupola the next morning, the crow was gone again. Like the day before, he soon emerged from his food cache under the cottonwood and flapped up to the weather vane. He gave me a sour look, but didn't rough up his feathers. I warmed myself for an hour or so, keeping my beak resolutely shut. This went on for a week. I never said a word on the cupola, till one day, a sharp cracking sound startled me into blurting out, "What was that?" "A rifle," the crow said. Not wanting to sound empty-headed, I didn't ask what this was. Before long, a human wearing a cap with ears.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.